Our hearts are as soft as an overripe pea.
Yes, 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 yes.
heart to conceive them enduring despair. If you knew what we suffer, you wouldn't impugn that pink of perfection, a heavy dragon.
And are you going a ticket for to buy?
Most certainly I am. Why shouldn't I?
Oh, fortune, this is hard. Blindfold your eyes. 2 minutes will decide who wins the prize.
None. hearted troubadour, whose mind's aesthetic and whose tastes are pure.
Aesthetic, he is aesthetic.
Yes, yes, I am aesthetic and poetic.
Dally long, Reginald, for my charms are ripe, Reginald, and already they are decaying. Better secure me ere I have gone too far. Sad is that woman's lot, oh, year by year. Sees one by one her beauties disappear. When time, grown weary of her heart-drawn sighs, impatiently begins to dim her eyes. Compelled at last in life's uncertain gloamings to wreathe her wrinkled brow with well-saved combings, reduced with rouge, lip shade, and pearly gray. Thank you.
fearlessly these maidens love me, and how hopelessly. Oh, patience, patience. With love of thee in my heart, what have I for these poor mad maidens but an unvalued pity? Alas, they will die of hopeless love for me, as I will die of hopeless love for thee.
So will it please you read to us?
Oh, yes, child, if you will. What shall I read?
Oh, one of your own poems.
One of my own poems? Better not, my child. They will not cure thee of thy love.
Mr. Bunthorne used to read us a poem of his own every day. And to do him justice, he read them extremely well.
Oh, did he so? Well, who am I that I should withhold my gifts from you? What am I but a trustee? Ah, here is a decollete.
Decollete.
A pure and simple thing, a very daisy. A babe might understand it. To appreciate it, it is not necessary to think of anything at all.
Oh, let us think of nothing at all.
Gentle Jane was good as gold. She always did as she was told. She never spoke when her mouth was full, or caught black beetles their legs to pull, or spilt plum jam on her nice new frock, or put white mice down the 8-day clock, or vivisected her last new doll, or fostered a passion for alcohol. And when she grew up, she was given in marriage to a first-class earl who keeps his carriage. I believe that I am correct in saying that there is not one word in that
decollete,
which is calculated to bring the blush of shame to the cheek of modesty.
Not one. It is purity itself.
Here's another. Teasing Tom was a very bad boy. A great big squirt was his favorite toy. He put live shrimps down his father's boots and sewed up the sleeves of his Sunday suits. He punched his poor little sister's heads and cayenne peppered their four-post beds. He plastered their hair with cobbler's wax and dropped hot halfpennies down their backs. The consequence was he was lost totally and married a girl from the corps de ballet.
Oh, mark you how grandly, how relentlessly.
The damning catalogue of crimes strode on. Retribution.
Like a poised hawk.
Came swooping down upon the wrongdoer.
Oh, this is terrible.
Oh, sir, you are indeed a true poet. For you touch our hearts, and they go out to you.
Oh, this is simply cloying. Ladies, I am sorry to appear ungallant, but this is Saturday, and you have been following me about ever since Monday. I should like the usual half holiday. I would take it as a personal favor if you would kindly allow me to close early today.
Oh, sir, don't satisfy me, please.
Oh, poor, poor girls. It is best to speak plainly. I know that I am loved by you. But I can never love you in return, for my heart is fixed elsewhere. Remember the fable of the maggot in the churn?
Oh, but we don't know the fable of the maggot in the churn.
Don't you?
No.
Then I will sing it to you. Oh. Dr. Vrachopoulos, if you will.
Magnet hung in a hardware shop, and all around was a loving crop of scissors and needles, nails and knives, offering love for all their lives. But for iron the magnet felt no whim. Though he charmed iron, it charmed not him. From needles and nails and knives he turned, for he set his love on a silver churn.
A silver churn.
Silver churn. He's most magnetic, very aesthetic. Fancy took this turn. If I can wheedle a knife for a needle, why not a silver churn?
He's most aesthetic, very magnetic. Fancy took this turn. If I can wheedle a knife for a needle, why not a silver churn?
and iron and steel expressed surprise. The needles opened their well-drilled eyes. The penknives felt shot up, no doubt. The scissors declared themselves cut out. The kettles they boiled with rage dissed, while every nail went off its head, and hither and thither began to roam, till a hammer came up and drove them home.
It drove them home.
It drove them home. While this magnetic, peripatetic lover, he lived to learn, by no endeavor can magnet ever attract a silver churn.
Well, this magnetic, peripatetic lover, he lived to learn, by no endeavor can magnet
ever attract a silver churn. At last they are gone. What is this mysterious fascination that I seem to exercise over all I come across? Oh, a curse on my fatal beauty, for I am sick of conquests. Patience!
I have escaped with great difficulty from my dear Reginald. I wanted to see you so much that I thought I might ask if you still love me as fondly as ever.
Love you? If the devotion of a lifetime.
Hold! Unhand me or I scream! As you are a gentleman, pray remember I am a lover's. You do still love me, don't you?
Madly, passionately, despairingly.
That's right. I never can be yours, but that's right.
Oh, and you love this Bunthorne?
With a heart-whole ecstasy that withers and scorches and stings and burns. It is my duty.
Admirable girl. But you are not happy with him.
Happy? I'm miserable beyond description.
That's right. I never can be yours, but that's right.
But go now. I see my dear Reginald approaching. Farewell, dear Archibald. I cannot tell you how happy I am to know that you still love me.
If I only dared.
Sir, such language to one who has promised to another. Oh, Archibald, I cannot tell you how happy I am. He is so mean to me. You would be so loving.
Loving?
Stop where you are. Unhand me, for as I am a good and pure woman, I'll scream. Farewell, dear Archibald. Stop there. Think of me sometimes. Advance one step and take care. Once more, adieu. There was a happy time when I didn't, but a bitter circumstance has taught me.
filling your rooms of will, laughing your teardrops down. Never a selfish will, trouble or pain to stir. Everything for him, nothing at all for her.
Damsel, you are.
No, not pretty. Massive.
Cheer up. I will never leave you, I swear it.
No, thank you. I know what it is. It's his confounded mildness. They find me too highly spiced, if you please. And no doubt I am highly spiced.
Not for my taste.
No, but I am for theirs. But I will show the world I can be as mild as he. If they want insipidity, they shall have it. I will meet this fellow on his own ground and beat him on it.
You shall, and I will help you.
You will, Jane. There's a good deal of good in you after all. I'll go to him and say to him with compliments satirical.
Say thank you, good day to you, and that's what you should say.
Your smile is much too mild and your appearance much too lyrical.
Say party, party, and that's what you should say.
I was the beau ideal of the morbid young aesthetical. To doubt my inspiration was regarded as heretical. Until you cut me up with your placidity pathetical.
Sing boo to you, boo to you, and that's what you should say.
Sing boo to you, boo to you, and that's what I should say.
Sing hey to you, good day.
Good day.
Sing to you, papa. Sing boo to you, boo to you, that's what you should say. Sing hey to you, good day. Sing boo to you, papa. Sing boo to you, and that's what you should say. Ba, boo, ba, boo, and that's what you should say.
His curly hair and stick an eyeglass in his ocular.
Sing bardew, ha ha dew, and that's what I should say.
To stuff his conversation full of quibble and of quiddity, to diamond chops and roly-poly pudding with avidity, he can clear away with all convenient rapidity.
Sing hey to you, good day to you, and that's what I should say.
Sing boo to you, boo to you, and that's what you should say.
Sing hey to you, good day.
alone retains its zest. To charm and please his devotees, we've done our little best. We're not quite sure that all we do has the early classic ring, but as far as we can judge, it's something like this sort of thing. You hold yourself like this, you hold yourself like that. By hook and crook, you hard to look, both angular and flat. We venture to expect that what we recollect, though not a part of truth, by what we have is to reject. If this is not exactly right, we hope you won't upbraid. You can't get half aesthetic taste like trousers ready-made. Produce from that secretion that time alone will bring. But as far as we can judge, it's something like this sort of thing. You hold yourself like this, you hold yourself like that. By hook and crook, you try to look both angular and flat. To cultivate a trim, rigidity of limb, you thought to get a marionette before your side on him.
Yes, it's quite clear that our only chance of making a lasting impression on these young ladies is to become as aesthetic as they are.
No doubt. The only question is how far we've succeeded in doing so. I don't know why, but I have an idea this is not quite right.
I don't like it. I never did. I don't understand what it means. I do it, but I don't like it.
My dear fellow, the point is not whether we like it, but whether they do. They understand these things. We don't. And I shouldn't be surprised if this is effective enough, at a distance.
Well, I can't help thinking we're a little stiff at it. It would be extremely awkward if we were to be struck so.
I don't think we shall be struck so. Perhaps we're just a bit stiff at it, but everything must have a beginning. Ah, here are the ladies. Attention!
Oh, Saphir! See, see! The immortal fire has descended on them, and they are of the inner brotherhood, perceptibly intense and consummately utter.
Oh, how Botticellian! How... Raw Angelicum! Oh, Art, we thank thee for this boon.
I'm afraid we're not quite right.
We're not supremely, perhaps, but all. So all. But, oh, Saphir, are they not quite too all but?
Oh, they are indeed jolly utter.
I wonder what the inner brotherhood usually recommend for a cramp.
Ladies, we will not deceive you. We are doing this at some personal inconvenience, with a view to expressing the extremity of our devotion to you. We trust that it is not without its effect.
Oh. Oh. Oh, we will not deny that we are much moved by this proof of your attachment.
Oh, yes. Your conversion to the principles of aesthetic art in its highest development has touched us deeply.
And if Mr. Grosvenor should remain obdurate,
which we have every reason to believe he will.
I wish they'd make haste.
We are not prepared to say that our yearning hearts will not go out to you.
Gentlemen, by sections of threes, rapture!
Oh, it's good. It's extremely good. For beginners, it's admirable.
The only question is who will take who?
Oh, the Duke chooses first, as a matter of course.
Oh, I couldn't think of it. You're really too good.
Not at all. You're a great matrimonial fish. And it's only fair that each of these young ladies should have a chance at hooking you. It's perfectly simple. Observe. Suppose you choose Saphir, Major takes Angela, I take nobody. Or suppose you choose Saphir, I take Angela, Major takes nobody. Or suppose you choose neither, Major takes Saphir, I take Angela. Clear as day.
Saphir I choose to marry, I shall be fixed up for life. Then the colonel need not tarry, Angela can be his wife. In the case of precedented single, I must live and die. I would have to be contented with her heart that sympathize.
He would have to be contented with her heart that sympathize.
On Angie, I determine at my wedding she'll appear. Deck the diamond and ermine, Major Lincoln takes a fear.
In the case of precedent, it's single, I must live and die. I will have to be contented with a heart that sympathize.
He will have to be contented with a heart that sympathize. In the case of precedent, it's single, I must live and die. He will have to be contented with a heart that sympathize.
Some debate internal, if on either I decide, Saphir then can take the colonel, and he be the major's wife. In the case of precedence, it's single, I shall live and die. I shall have to be contented with the heart that sympathize.
You will have to be contented with the heart that sympathize. In the case of precedence, it's single, he will live and die. He will have to be contented with the heart that sympathize.
Pleasant to be alone.
Oh, it is pleasant to be able to gaze at leisure upon those features which all others may gaze on at their goodwill. Ah, I am a very narcissist. Ah. It's no use. I can't live without admiration. Ever since Grosvenor came here, insipidity has been at a premium.
Ah, he is there.
Ah, Bunthorne, come here, look. Very graceful, isn't it?
Allow me. I haven't seen it yet.
Yes, it is graceful.
Oh, good gracious, not that. This.
You don't mean that. Bah, I'm in no mood for trifling.
And what is amiss?
Ever since you came here, you have entirely monopolized the attentions of the young ladies. I don't like it, sir.
My dear sir, how can I help it? They are the plague of my life.
My dear Mr. Bunthorne, with your personal disadvantages, you can have no idea of the inconvenience of being madly loved at first sight by every woman you meet.
Sir, until you came here, I was adored.
Exactly. That's my grievance. I cut everybody out. I assure you, Mr. Bunthorne, if you could only suggest some means whereby, consistent with my duty to society, I could rid myself of these inconvenient attentions, you would earn my everlasting gratitude, sir.
I will do so at once. However popular it may be with the world at large, your personal appearance is highly objectionable to me.
It is? Why, thank you. Thank you very much. How can I express my gratitude?
By making a complete change at once. You must eschew your antique garb and get sensible shoes. Your conversation must henceforth be perfectly matter-of-fact. In conversation and appearance, you must be absolutely commonplace.
No, pardon me, that's impossible.
Take care when I am thwarted.
I am very terrible.
I can't help that. I am a man with a mission, and that mission must be fulfilled.
I don't think you quite appreciate the consequences of thwarting me.
I don't care what they are.
Suppose I don't go so far as to say that I would actually do it, but suppose I were to curse you. Very well. Take care.
But surely you would never do that.
Oh, I don't know. It is an extreme measure, no doubt. Still...
Oh, but you would not do it. I am sure you would not. Oh, Mr. Bunthorne, reflect, reflect. You had a mother once.
Never.
Then you had an aunt. Ah, I see that you had. By the memory of that aunt, I implore you to pause and resort to this last fearful expedient. Oh, Mr. Bunthorne, reflect, reflect.
I must not allow myself to be unmanned. Oh,
consent at once, or may a nephew's curse.
Hold! Are you absolutely resolved?
Absolutely.
Will nothing shake you?
Nothing. I am adamant.
Very good. Then I yield.
Ha! You swear it?
I do, cheerfully. I have long sought for a pretext such as you suggest. It has come at last. I do it on compulsion.
A victory! I triumph!
When I go out of doors, of damsels a score, all sighing and yearning and clinging and burning will follow me as before. I shall with cultured taste distinguish gems from paste, and heighted and tittle will rank as an idiot if I pronounce it chaste.
A most intense young man, a soulful eyed young man, an ultra poetical, super aesthetical, out of the way young man. Conceive me if you can, an everyday young man, a regular guy with a jacket and tie and a corporate dental plan, whose brain is blithely free of art and poetry, who doesn't need Dryden, Da Vinci, or Haydn when he can watch TV. A commonplace young man, a feet on the desk young man, a dull mediocre Friday night rockery everyday young man.
A Japanese young man,
a blue and white young man,
Francesca da Rimini, Mimini, Bimini, je ne sais quoi young man.
Reg, a 9-to-5 young man, a mow the lawn young man, karaoke musician, a swimsuit addition, a toss me a brew young man.
A paladin thin young man, a haggard and lank young man, a greenery gallery, Seattle art gallery, pro NEA young man.
A surf and turf young man, a wash the car young man, drive deficit double again, votes rate Republican, Bush and Quail young man. See me if you can, every day young man, an ultra-poetical, frigid, aesthetical, out of the way young man. Conceive me if you can, a every day young man, an ultra-poetical, frigid, aesthetical, every day young man.
All right. I have committed my last act of ill nature and am henceforth a changed character. La 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 la.
Dancing.
La, 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 la.
Oh, and what on earth is the matter with you?
Patience. I'm a changed man. Hitherto I've been gloomy, moody, fitful, uncertain in temper, and selfish in disposition.
You have indeed.
All that has changed. I've reformed. I've muddled myself after Mr. Grosvenor. Henceforth, I am mildly cheerful. My conversation will blend amusement with instruction. I shall still be aesthetic, but my aestheticism will be of a most pastoral kind.
Oh, Reginald, is all of this true?
Quite true. Observe how amiable I am.
Oh, but Reginald, how long will this last?
With occasional intervals for rest and refreshment, as long as I do.
Oh, Reginald, I am so happy! Oh, dear, dear Reginald, I cannot express the joy I feel at this change. It will no longer be a duty to love you, but a pleasure, a rapture, an ecstasy.
Oh, my darling!
Oh, horror.
What's the matter?
Is it absolutely certain that you have absolutely reformed, that you are henceforth a perfect being, utterly free from defect of any kind?
It's quite true. I have sworn it.
Oh, then I never can be yours.
Why not?
unselfish in loving such a perfect being as you.
But stop a bit. I don't want to change. I'll be as I was. Oh, interrupted!
I'm a Costco and Ernst young man, a mariner's cap young man, a dull mediocre Friday night pokery every day young man.
We're Bellevue Square young girls, we're Nordstrom Sale young girls, we're twiddly tethery, cheerily chattering every day young girls.
Angela! Ella! Saphir! What is the meaning of this?
Well, it means that Archibald the All Right cannot be all wrong. And if the All Right has decided to discard aestheticism, well, it proves aestheticism on his card.
Oh, Archibald! Archibald! This is terrible! I'm shocked! Dismayed! Horrified!
I can't help it. It's not my fault. I'm not a free agent. I do it on compulsion.
Go! I'll never set eyes on you again. No, this is terrible! Oh, but Joy!
What's the matter?
Is it quite certain that you will always be a commonplace young man?
Always. I have sworn it.
Oh, why, then there's nothing to prevent me from loving you with all the fervor of my command.
Why, that's true.
Oh, my Archibald!
My patience!
Oh, crushed again!
Cheer up! I am still here. I have never left you, and I never will.
Jane, after all, there's no denying it. You are a fine figure of a woman.
My Reginald.
My Jane.
Ladies, the Duke has at great length condescended to select a bride.
I have a great gift to bestow. Approach such of you as are truly lovely. In personal appearance, you have all that is necessary to make a woman happy. In common fairness, I think I ought to choose the only one among you who has the misfortune to be distinctly plain. Jane!
Duke!
Oh! Again!
After much debate, internal eye on Lady Jane decide, and ye now may take the Colonel Saphir, be the Major's bride.
In that case unprecedented single, I shall live and die. I shall have to be contented with a tulip or a lily.
He will have to be contented with a tulip or a lily. In that case unprecedented single, he must live and die. He will have to be contented with the tulip or the lily. Great things upon another token very big aside. Each of us will wed the other. Nobody will cry.
Thank you.
patience for a moment, please? This lily that I picked up at QFC.
That's not a lily?
It's not a lily. Well, whatever this is, Penny, we present you with it.
Wendy. Wendy.
Dan Reinke.
Dan.
Our technical director.